Ladies and gentlemen, it's a great honor for me and Ari to be here and introduce you Finnish education and especially teacher education. I would like to thank especially Nadine, Sarah and Elizabeth for inviting here and for having a very fruitful collaboration before our meeting here, and I hope that it will continue as fruitful as until now. So we are coming from the very northern part of Europe. Our country, if we have a look for the area, it's quite big, only 1/4 of the South Africa, but the population is only 1/10 of South Africa. Our country is well known of our welfare system and education system. And my presentation is, of course, it's focusing to the teacher education and training school system, but it's very difficult to understand a system of another country without knowing something about the context. And secondly, I would also like to somehow anchorize my presentation to the research on teachers or effective professional teachers. So I have in the very beginning, I have some slides about how in the research literature teachers are definite how, when they are effective or professional. And then if there's some time, I would like to say something about the quality system we are following. So there are different approaches to figure out what kind of teachers we should educate and what we would like to have at our schools. And in Anglo-Saxon countries, in United States and United Kingdom, they are very much talking about effective teachers. But instead of effective concept, they are also using, not in the Anglo-Saxon country, but in other countries, the term professional, competent, expert, quality, ideal, and respective, and so on. There are at least three main approaches how to make a definition for effective teacher. And in the research literature, they are named output, input, and process approach. The most popular used approach to the teacher effectiveness is this output approach. It is in United States, United Kingdom, very well established. And in those countries, the effectiveness of teacher is recognized in the learning outcomes of the students, enjoy the teaching of teachers. And this approach is very close to the accountability policy, which is very heavy in United States and United Kingdom. Our approach, if we are willing to say or use the effectiveness, it could be called input approach. The idea in input approach is that countries who are following this are aiming to educate teachers as well as possible in a long program, master level program. And then they wish, if teachers are educated well, they survive well in a classroom and work as effective. This is not a simple approach, a simple idea, because we know that in addition to education, teachers take also their personal beliefs to the classroom, and also the whole education context have influence to this, how effective teacher in the classroom. And the process approach is kind of mixed. It is also focusing to the processes in the classroom and looking correlation between processes and outcomes. So Finnish approach is close to the input approach, very far away from the Anglo-Saxon approach, which could be named as output approach. And actually, I mentioned that we are not using the term effective teacher, we are more or less using the professional teacher. And what is the meaning of that kind of teacher? You can again find from the research literature some definitions how we understand what we mean with the professional teacher. And the teacher professionalism refers to the status of teachers. And at least there are three topics it depends. So the cultural and education policy factors have an effect when we are discussing about professionality of the teachers. And school-level factors, for example, the shared leadership idea, collaboration between teachers, And also, of course, the individual factors, how well teachers are educated and how well they have adopted the idea during the education is emphasizing. And in the research literature, it is emphasized that all those are important when we are discussing about professional teachers. And in Finnish situation, Finnish context, it is fact that all those, the culture, education, school level factors and teacher level factors, they have to take into account when we are discussing about the professionalism of the teachers. However, there, if you are willing to have a look for more detail about the definitions and what is found in the research literature, there are a lot of terms used in while the researchers are describing what we mean with professional teachers. Autonomous is important. They are free from the very heavy centralized system, self-regulation, knowledge base, professional ideology, values and ethical topics are important, and so on. So this is kind of theoretical framework for my presentation. However, I'm very much looking for practical topics, but maybe this helped you a little bit understand more what I am talking here. There's a framework for this. And second, teacher education is very national business. So we are educating in Finland teachers to our society, our education context. And if you do not know anything about our context, it is not possible to understand how and why we are educating teachers as we are educating them. So some words about our context. So there are maybe four important characteristics of our education policy, implementation of the policy. The first one is the long-term policy. We are not making rapid changes. Actually, we are not making changes in the similar meaning of change as it is done in many other countries. Our education life is very peaceful. And most important decisions were made 40 years ago. That time it was decided that all teachers should be educated at universities, not institutes, but universities in 5-year programs, master level programs. At the same time, it was decided that we should have same school for everybody, very ideological idea, but that was implemented also. We are not having any private schools in Finland. So all schools are public schools. And if you look at PISA data, the variation between school is almost zero in Finland. So we are very happy. All schools are very good schools. And the results are very similar in those schools. Equality is one of the most underlying idea in our education policy and implementation. Everything is free in compulsory school. School meals, transport, healthcare, psychological services, and special need education is well organized, in my opinion, and many others share the idea. So every teacher, for example, in our teacher education program, in secondary and primary, have to learn the basics of special need and have to at least recognize if the students have special needs. Decentralization is a big issue. We have all very short documents at the national level. There's a huge amount of local level decision making. At universities, all universities are making own programs. All schools are making, or at least municipalities are making, or districts are making local level curriculum based on the national guidelines. Assessment is at local level. And this means that school principals are really in charge of organizing this kind of thing, organizing the local curriculum work, organizing, looking for assessment and supporting teachers to make fair assessment, also responsible for development of the school culture and operations. And finally, the fourth big topic is trust culture. We have had, until the last 20 years, we do not have any inspectors, we do not have any national testing. So we trust teachers, and we think that they are professionals, they are able to implement all things. So, but the trust is not based on, it doesn't exist as such. So We know that nowadays, because the decisions were made 40 years ago, now all teachers are masters. They have a research orientation. They are academic professionals. So that's why we do not need inspectors or testing. In the end of high school, we have a national test. And you can easily find also from the research literature outside Finland that also the other people share this idea how we, what is the nature of our education policy. For example, very well-known journal in natural sciences, Science, 300 years old journal. The editor is writing in editorial that Finland acknowledges the central role of teachers and the respect is important in our society. So we have the national level curriculum, and as I mentioned already, the schools or district have to implement it at the local level. And the assessment is at local level. And if you are willing to find some evidence for this kind of talk, if you just take a look for PISA school questionnaires, and then you find that almost every school, every teacher who has been answering the school questionnaire of the PISA test, 2000, 2003, 2006, 2009, and so on, they really feel that they are responsible for disciplinary or curriculum policy and assessment policy. In OECD countries, it's 70% are feeling like that. So in Finland, the subjects, we are not focusing only to some subjects. We give equal value to all subjects. And this is the allocation of lesson hours for subjects in whole compulsory school, from grade 1 to grade 9. We emphasize languages. Languages are important. Language is a tool for thinking, tool for learning. Also, the foreign languages are important. So, 1/3 of the lesson hours are allocated for languages. And then, other 1/3 is for mathematics and science, or if we take social science and religious, then 1/3 is for those. And what is the rest? The rest is for physical education, art education, music education. So in my understanding, it's very balanced with the languages, math and science, but also the arts. We give them huge value. And then some optional studies. And okay, the assessment, because in many countries like United Kingdom, United States, the assessment is actually driving the school. And it's actually the main ideology, main component in this output approach to the teacher effectiveness. So the effectiveness of the teacher is seen in the outcome, learning outcomes of students. So I make a comparison between the assessment culture in United States, United Kingdom, and assessment culture in Finland. So because this is very important in education, the assessment. We are not against assessment, it is important, but it is very much classroom-based assessment and school-level assessment. In Anglo-Saxon countries, the approach is very much called outcome-based model. So the aims in the curriculum, they are described as learning outcomes. Very detailed descriptions, several pages. Important level is a district level because the district are organizing the testing for schools. Of course, there are a lot of positive. People do not have this kind of system if there are any positive. But positive things are, for example, that the learner and the teacher knows exactly what he or she should teach and what he or she should learn. And also the design of test items is very fair based on these outcome descriptions. And there's also a lot of negative points in this approach. The heavy competition at school and also the control of outcomes guides all kind of actions at school. And we know that teaching to the test is very common word in US discussion. Our model, input model, we are having broad aims. In a national level, our whole curriculum is about 100 pages. It's for all grades, all subjects, very short descriptions, what are the main aims. And then at the local level, the teachers should implement and decide how they focus An assessment is at the school level or even classroom level. Because we are not having testing, because there is much planning at the school level, the co-planning is important. And the process is important because nobody is afraid of tests. So the process, learning process is in central. And the teacher conducted assessment, we understand the assessment is for improvement. So assessment is not for punishment, but it is a way how to improve things. We like assessment, but it is for improvements. And the problematic is the comparison, because grading is based on teacher gradings. So this is the comparison of students is problematic in this system. But we accept this negative side. Okay, this was all background. I start with this kind of theoretical frame, teacher professionalism, teacher effectiveness, and then I take some slides dealing with Finnish education context, and now I come to the main topic, teacher education. This is our main building of our university. Okay, I will start with one slide coming out of Finland. The United States company, the name is McKinsey & Company, they clarify what is common with teacher education in those countries where students are getting high results in PISA. And this call was coming from the United States government. They were willing to know how teacher education is organized in Finland, in Singapore, and South Korea. What is common and what is not common. And this is what comes out in the McKinsey & Company report. I start with number 7. So teaching is considered as a career. And this is very important in Finland. The teacher profession is a career. It's an academic career. It is very much comparable to the lawyer or medical doctor. Maybe not exactly the same, but very close to these occupations. And the number 1, selective admission. This is consequence, I think the main consequence of this understanding that teacher profession is a career, is a selective admission. And for example, in our primary teacher education program, we have every year 3,000 applicants and we take only 120. It's about 7%. So it's a very heavy competition to teach education. It's most popular topic at our university. Our university is among the best 100 universities. And can you imagine? The teacher education is the most popular. There are a lot of, most applicants are coming to teacher education. There are more applicants than to medical education. It's more difficult to come to teacher education than go to medical school. So it's quite amazing, actually, also for us. If I take Sweden, which is our neighbor country, in Sweden they have had 3 or 4 year education for primary teachers. Until now, they are now changing the system. And in Sweden, they take everybody who is coming to teach education. And they have even problems, there is not enough students coming. And in my understanding, this status, this academic status is the most important reason why we have so many teachers coming to our, because our society is, Finland and Sweden is very similar. In secondary teacher education in Sweden, it's more serious lack of candidates. In whole Sweden, they have only 2 students in chemistry teacher education. So the status of teachers is important. And also the cultural respect, number 6. And they were also very similar in South Korea and Singapore. Teacher salary in Finland is not the reason why they are coming to teacher education. It is reason in South Korea and Singapore the salaries there is the highest in the world. We are in the middle of the OECD rankings. Okay. I have emphasized this decentralization, but although we have the decentralized system, it is very clever to have inside one country some general policy. And we have also in teacher education a general policy. This policy was published in 2002, it's more than 10 years old document. It was only 3 pages large, it's a very short document, in a national level. And universities have to take into account that. So these are examples of the sentences I just pick up from the document. And I can group them to 3 parts. And these three areas, professionalism, partnership skills, and lifelong learning skills, actually they are coming from the European Union new documents. The Union is pushing member states to the organized teacher education so that it emphasizes the professionality, partnership, and lifelong learning. And you can easily find from Finnish documents, more than 10 years old documents, these topics. So the subject knowledge, pedagogical knowledge, social skills, moral knowledge, they are the professionality. Partnership, schools are not isolated, they are part of the society, it's important to collaborate with the society, especially parents. There are a lot of good collaboration models for school-family collaboration. And the lifelong learning. In Finnish strategy, the academic skills, research-making skills, they are emphasized in the documents. And also the universities take seriously that every teacher should have a research orientation. Let's have a look now more carefully or more detail to the different kind of programs we have for teacher education. So I have at my department we have six programs: kindergarten, primary, secondary. In secondary we have only pedagogical studies. Then we have special education, home economics, craft science. We have altogether 220 staff members, so it's a rather big department, and 3,000 students. So we have one is secondary teacher education program at our university, but we take only care of the pedagogical studies. Secondary teachers are teaching at grade 7 to 12, and typically they are teaching two subjects. And elementary primary teachers are teaching at grades 1 to 6, and typically all those 13 subjects. Okay, at grade 1 we have only 5 subjects, but if we take the whole primary grade 1 to 6, we have 13 school subjects. So our university is a very big university, almost as big as Johannesburg, but a little bit smaller. Altogether about 40,000 students and 11 faculties, 7,000 staff members. And 6 faculties are participating in teacher education. So it's not only one department, one faculty, but 6 faculties are participating. I'm coming from the Faculty of Behavioral Sciences, and inside the faculty, we have Department of Teacher Education with these 200 staff members, and we have Teacher Training School. Ari is coming from Teacher Training School, and we have altogether 150 teachers, something like that, working in those schools. Actually, they are physically 2 schools, but they are understood as a one unit. And then Faculty of Arts, Science, Bioscience, Theology and Social Science are participating. Secondary teacher education is a common joint program. The subject studies are done at the department of specific subject, like physics department, history department, and the pedagogical studies at our department. And the primary teacher education program is mainly organized at the Department of Teacher Education and Teacher Training Schools, and partly they can take a minor from other faculties. So teacher education is a joint activity inside our university. And it's also emphasized in our documents. Let's have a look more closely to the structure of the degree. So the master level degree is what is needed for teacher profession and for primary and secondary level. And secondary, this program is divided according to Bologna Agreement in European Union to the bachelor and master level. But it's very technical. So in Finland you actually need both, bachelor and master, and then you get the qualification. But students start with major subject studies, Department of Physics and maybe minor Department of Mathematics. And they are typically coming to the pedagogical studies organized by our department during the third autumn. So they take 2 years at the department of specific subject. Actually, there are also some activities focusing on teacher education. It's not only our activity. And then they come to pedagogical studies and they have the first training during the third autumn, very early. And then they continue during the fourth year, typically, and take the second training at the teacher training school. And there are also some communication and language studies. Now I would like to emphasize 2 most important characteristics of our program. The first, the teaching practice. Teaching practice is 1/3 of the pedagogical studies. And in our understanding, it is the place where student teachers integrate subject knowledge and pedagogical knowledge, pedagogical content knowledge, and also the school practice. Some kind of very subjective pedagogical view or theory. So we are looking for subjective understanding of teaching and learning, because we think that every teacher have to build up their own view, how I am teaching, how students are learning. We are not making one model teachers, we appreciate diversity. And the second is research orientation. In secondary teacher education, student teachers make 3 theses within their studies. And they all should be like research papers. The master thesis is about almost 1 year project. There must be framework and questions and methodology and results and discussion. And we think in Finland that this makes teachers academic professionals, this research orientation. And they need this research orientation. They are not making research when they are but they need the orientation to research, because they have to plan curriculum, they have to organize assessment, they have to learn new knowledge in pedagogy and subject. It's very important orientation. So that our trust, and we are not having inspectors, it is based on the professionalism of teachers. Without that, we are not able to have. Teaching practice, it depends on the program. As I mentioned, we have 6 programs, about 14 to 17 weeks. But it is equal to 20 credits. So 20 credits is 1/3 of year. And again, depend on the program, about 1/2 to 2/3 of the teaching practice take place in the teach training schools, and the other is ordinary municipality schools. However, we have also trained those teachers who are mentoring our students in municipality schools. There are typically phases. It starts kind of orientation or introduction. It's a basic practice where basic skills are trained, and then advanced practice, which is more advanced and more independent from the supervisor. So there are different kind of aims for each level. It's also cumulative learning. It comes more challenging. The how much supervisor is supervising is coming smaller to when we are coming to the end. But of course, supervisor is all the time available for discussion. And the pedagogical studies, I'm not going to detail, but shortly, 60 credits is this whole package. 13 credits is for general education, 17 credits for pedagogical content knowledge. In Finland, we call it didactics. It's a German didactics, not UK didactics. And then educational research, 10 credits, and teaching practice, 20 credits. And there are some 15 courses altogether. And also there's some departments, for example, physics departments are offering own courses. Now I'm coming to the primary teacher education program. So basically it looks very similar, the bachelor level and master level, and you need the whole package for your qualification. The major subject, it is education or educational psychology. Our student teachers are selecting the major. The multidisciplinary studies is studies of all school subjects, pedagogical content knowledge. So how to teach physics, how to teach history, how to learn that, what kind of difficulties students have in learning that subject. So it's not so much focusing to the subject knowledge, but more pedagogical content knowledge. And this means that in Finnish teacher education, in primary teacher education, we are not emphasizing so much subject matter knowledge. But you remember that I mentioned that we are able to select 120 from 3,000. So they are very high quality students, best of the best. So it's not so necessary to train basics of all subjects. And the minor, they can select themselves. It is the, for example, combination of history and religious, or it could be media education, environmental education. It could be mathematics, so they can choose themselves. And inside the major, they have two theses, bachelor thesis and master thesis, and also the teaching practice is inside the major. And it is the equal to the secondary teacher. It's 20 credits. And then pedagogical studies it is not a separate as it is in secondary teacher education. Pedagogical studies is inside the major subject. And now some reflection, what is kind of core in pedagogical studies? The pedagogical studies very much support the integration of knowledge. And this personal pedagogical view is the aim. So it's subjective approach. The different dimensions of teacher profession, collaboration with families, the historical, philosophical, sociological basis for education, reflection is important. So because we do not have inspectors, we do not have testing, we don't have this kind of governmental way of supporting teacher development, that every teacher have to learn how to make reflection for, in, and in, on action, before the lessons, during the lessons, and afterwards. So teachers should ask all the time, what was working well, where I have challenges, what I have to do next time better. So this kind of thinking is important in teacher profession. And of course, the lifelong learning potentials. This is the picture of the teacher training school where Ari is coming. It's a quite modern building, and there's the from primary to secondary. All students are in the same building, but there are different areas for each student and even different playgrounds for each student. This is the entrance. This is the playground for younger students. This is the cafeteria. We offer warm meal for every student. Every student gets a warm meal, and it's very high quality meal. Computers are used. There are different kind of activities, dancing, playing, gaming, not only heavy studying. And of course the celebrations in the before the Christmas time, there's a celebration, and in the end of school year, there's this kind of, they are the those who are ending the high school. They get the white hat and the diploma from high school. So I have emphasized that teaching practice is very important part in teacher education. It is the place where different kind of knowledge are integrated, and also the reflective activities are learned. So there are four interacting participants in teaching practice. Of course, the student and the other students, and we are pushing them to collaborate. So there are, especially in primary teacher education, it is kind of practice that at least two students are working together as pair. They are planning together, they are observing each other lessons, they are working as a support teacher during the lesson the other student is teaching. And the mentor teacher, like Ari, and then of course sometimes the university lecturer is visiting the school and maybe organizing more general reflective activities, kind of make supporting the making of summary and completing the portfolio and things like that. The aim of the interaction or dialogue is to develop planning, teaching, assessing, and metacognitive skills to conceptualize through reflective activities. I have analyzed our secondary teacher education program together with some Korean teacher educators. We make a comparative study, what kind of things we are emphasizing, and where is the teacher knowledge coming from? Is it coming from practice, or is it coming from theory, textbooks? And in the comparison in Finland, the aims for studies, they are emphasizing both. The student teachers should learn almost as much from the theories, textbooks, lectures, or from practice. We are also using video recordings during our lectures. So it's very balanced, learning from theory and practice. And in the case, if you are learning something from practice, the conceptualization is important. So I have emphasized the subjective view, but of course in a scientific discourse everybody should have the same concepts. So the concept should be the similar, but the view, how to support student learning, there are some differentiation. And apply theory in practice. All those teachers who are supervising, like Ari, they should have double master. They should have a master in the subject and also master in pedagogy or education. So they are very qualified teachers. They are able to support also the combining of theory to practice. We have altogether in Finland 8 universities where teacher education is organized, but we have a bigger number of practice teacher training schools. We have altogether 13. So this Johannesburg is 2 times Finland, so you should have 26 teacher training schools. That it's enough for your city. Okay, Ari is teaching ordinary students. He's teaching also the students maybe 13 hours per week, and the next 6-7 hours is used for supervising. And he's also responsible for research and development activities, as all teachers in teacher training school. And they are also organizing different kind of in-service training activities, especially in the field of ICT. I already mentioned that you have to be very qualified, you have to be good in teaching, you have to demonstrate that, you have to have this double master. And I already mentioned that teacher training schools are participating in research. So we are so happy at the department because teacher training schools are collecting permission from families. So they have already the permission from families so that the families accept that we are able to organize research activities in those schools. And also the teachers are organizing that. So this kind of ethically correct way of making research is very easy in Helsinki. And the 17%, we have, after master you are able to make a licentiate, it is in the middle of the PhD, and then we have PhD. 70% of the teachers in teacher training school are PhD or licentiate. So they are high quality teachers. And the in-service training, they are having different kind of in-service training. This picture is our department. Actually, we have 5 big buildings because we have these 200 staff members. This is the main building and the administrative office, and my office is located there. Some words about the quality. I have emphasized that we are not having inspectors, we are not having heavy guidelines. Everything is happening at the local level. So in teacher education, there is research on quality a lot. But there is also this type of research that if we are not having inspection, if we are not having heavy centralized system, how happy people are there? So for example, Wolf is writing and arguing based on the results of research results that the focus in quality assurance, a quality work, is turning more and more to mastering changes and allowing ownership for development. So the quality work should happen at the local level, at the school level, at the department level. And this is the way how people are feeling ownership for quality work. And Ehlers write quite recently, in teacher education we need more methods and practices that get deeper into organization and close to the teacher educators and learners. So the external quality work is not good for ownership and the success of the quality work. And again, I have emphasized the local level decision making, but however it's very important to have also centralized guidance. So we have national level office for quality, but the office is not organizing quality assurance as such. It is organizing the visits where they are looking how the quality work is done. And this is called auditing processes. So for example, our university and department, the quality procedures have been audited. And this means that the external people are coming and we are discussing them, how we are organizing quality. Then we have the institutional university level quality office. I'm the part of the university level quality team participating in the discussions there. And we are also supporting departments and faculties for doing the quality work. And then the most important is the department and program level. And actually, in Finland, we are not using the term quality assurance or quality control. We are calling it quality culture. So it should happen at the local level. And this culture is important in quality work. This is a little bit somehow related to the quality, but just information. This is not so well fitting with my presentation. But assessment of teachers. How we assess teachers. It is part of the quality work. Okay, the Finnish trends and opposite trends. In Finland, the qualification is easy. If you make your master level degree, then you are qualified teacher. You have had the teaching practice and you have made the master thesis, and this demonstrates the quality enough. In many countries, like United States, it's very complex procedures they are following, how they recognize that the teacher is a qualified teacher. The teachers in US apply to the National Board of Professional Teaching Standards. They use portfolios, videos, and things like that. It's very difficult to go in. You have to demonstrate that. We are not having standards for teachers. Many other countries are having heavy standards. For example, Australian professional standards for teachers. We think that the master level degree gives you the professionality you need. This is very much related to input approach and also the professionality I make references in the beginning. Self-assessment is important and discussions. The principal has the key role in organizing discussions with teachers. Every year there should be discussions about the outcomes of your work and the quality discussions. In many countries, like in South Korea, there's external appraisal and writing of evaluation sheets and very heavy procedures. We have no inspectors. Many countries there's heavy inspection. And we have no national testing at the comprehensive school. In many countries, teachers are valued based on their student success in national level. So this is the comparison of teacher assessment. A discussion. So if we use this term effectiveness of teacher and teacher effectiveness, in a traditional meaning, Finnish teachers are very effective, although we are not following the procedures how other countries are recognizing the effectiveness. Okay, we are participating in the PISA test and TIMSS test, and the outcomes of those tests demonstrate that teachers, okay, the students get high results in PISA. So, and what is something we are more proud, maybe that where we are in the rankings is not so important. For teacher educators, the most important is that the variation in performance is very small, and especially the variation between schools. And this is very much reflecting our policy. So the policy is successful in this sense. Teacher effectiveness. Effectiveness, action and professionalism could be discussed in the context of input instead of widely accepted output approach. And Finnish teachers are professionals who have solid knowledge base in pedagogical knowledge, pedagogical content knowledge, subject knowledge. They are able to act as academic professionals. They can plan, implement and assess. They can collaborate in school communities and so on. They have also learned how to consume and produce educational research. This is one important aim in teacher education. And this knowledge they need in local level curriculum and assessment practices. And for lifelong learning, it is important that you have this research orientation. And my final slide is more opinion. What we need in education, we need more professionalism, less bureaucracy. We need more equal opportunities, less parents' money. We need more decentralization, less standardization. We need more trust, not test-based accountability. More collaboration, less competition. So this is my last slide, and I would like to close my presentation with these opinions. Thank you.